1 p.m. right here at Stony Brook, and it is time for Play It Forward.
Yes.
And I say, take it away, people.
On WUSB Stony Brook 90.1 and 107.3 FM. Happy Friday, everyone.
Happy Friday.
Alongside me is my co-host and fellow advocate of Play Forward, the remarkable Kurt Hall. And shout out to Taylor. Prayers for Coco. Taylor, study for that math test. We're thinking of you. Momentarily, we will be introducing our guests here in the studio, two moms who tragically lost their sons to an overdose, Claudia Friszell and Lori Carbonaro. We will be with you in a bit. But before we begin our interview with Claudia and Lori, we would like to offer our deepest sympathy to those lost in the Maui wildfires and support the efforts of those in need. Please donate. So let's pass the mic to Kurt for a closer look at what Play It Forward is all about.
Good afternoon, listeners. I'd like to take you into the heart and soul of the Play It Forward project. We are a dynamic movement, a nonprofit aimed at illuminating the dark corners where fentanyl, opioids, and substances like to hang out. Our end game? Empowering students and communities with the kind of wisdom that sparks resilience and steers us toward a safer and brighter tomorrow. We're diving headfirst into the nitty-gritty of drug know-how, waving the prevention flag high, and shouting out strategies that actually work, all rooted in solid, evidence-based harm reduction. Side by side with those navigating the recovery path, we're serving up unwavering support and vital resources that can truly make a difference. Join the movement on Instagram at sbu.playitforward, that's all one word, and check out our dynamic content on YouTube at the Play It Forward Project, again, all one word. Connect with us and become a crucial part of a larger purpose. We broadcast from Stony Brook Radio, Stony Brook University radio station every other Friday, 1 to 2 p.m. Here is Allison with some essential insights about fentanyl.
Thank you, Kurt. Fentanyl, a highly potent synthetic opioid, is 50 times stronger than heroin. As little as 2 milligrams of fentanyl has been killing many people every day. Here's a visual. Picture a penny. That amount will fit on Abraham Lincoln's nose. This deadly opioid kills one person on an average of every 11 minutes, making the leading cause of death for adults 18 to 45. Fentanyl now is more than ever laced with illicit street drugs. We should know that fentanyl mainly comes from Mexico, and Mexico gets cheap precursor compounds to make fentanyl from China. Many drug dealers have been mixing fentanyl with other drugs to increase their potency, addictiveness, and fentanyl is also used as a cutting agent to dilute expensive drugs and increase profits. Unintentional contamination also occurs where fentanyl is unknowingly present in illicit drugs. This may be a cross-contamination in illicit drug making or because of poor handling practices. These are things we cannot control. Fentanyl test strips are available at various harm reduction sites, community health centers, and you can buy fentanyl test strips from other online retailers.
We firmly believe raising awareness about fentanyl extends beyond highlighting its negative impact. It also entails empowering individuals to make informed choices, protect their well-being, and contribute to a safer, more compassionate society. Fentanyl's devastating toll claims over 200 lives each day. This heart-wrenching reality is similar to a commercial plane crashing every single day. These are not mere statistics. They are individuals who once enriched our society and are deeply missed. Each loss leaves an irreplaceable void that cannot be filled. The Play It Forward Project aims to help reduce overdoses, promote safe use practices, foster open dialogues, bolster prevention efforts, and combat stigma. Without further ado, here's Allison to introduce our guests.
Thank you, Kurt. So I'd like to welcome Claudia Friszell and Lori Carbonaro to the show. A warm welcome to you on behalf of Play It Forward. We are incredibly grateful for you being here today and appreciate your dedication and contributions to the community. So Claudia and Lori, why don't you tell our listeners about yourselves and the roles in your community, our community, to help fight for this cause. Claudia?
Wow. Hi. Thank you very much for having me.
That's a lot to follow.
That is a lot to follow.
Oh, please.
But yeah, I'll do my best. I'll do my best.
And then I got to go after her.
Yeah. That's a hard act to follow.
So My name's Claudia Friszell, as you indicated. I've lived in this area for over 30 years. I grew up and lived on Long Island my whole life. My dad was a advocate for addiction and recovery from back in the 60s and 70s. So I feel like I grew up in the community of advocacy. And so having done that, I thought I would be immune to any of the side effects of addiction. Sadly, that was mistaken. I have joined just about every organization that doesn't kick me out. I volunteer at Hope House Ministries. I've been part of Families in Supported Treatment, Lyra, Thrive Recovery Center, LICAD, and countless others. And again, I do whatever I can. My main goal personally is to help families go through and process, educate, prevent, support those families who have someone that struggles with substance use disorder. I think that it's super important that we have the conversations with our children early. I think we as the human community owe it to ourselves and each other and the future to learn as much as you can and to have empathy for each other and compassion instead of judgment.
Absolutely.
So that's really me in a nutshell. Oh,
thank you, Claudia. Thanks so much. Hey, well, Lori.
Thanks for having us. Usually what happens is Claudia does that and I just say, okay, what Claudia said, but there's a lot different. While our bottom line is the same that we didn't lose our kids. We know where they are to addiction. My story is different in that there was no education and awareness to that, what Claudia has had in her life as a young person. Having said that, my father was what you would consider, I would consider, I shouldn't say anybody else, because my siblings don't always agree with me. He was a functioning alcoholic. I knew in my young life that I definitely could have been. After I had my kids, after I think my oldest, Michael, was about 15, I had an incident in my life that, no, this isn't going to happen. And we did have the conversations. We put the tools that we were given back then in the toolbox.
Okay.
Not exactly what we need today, for sure.
Yeah.
And now we have families that are devastated and trying to endure this. Nobody thought ever in their wildest dreams, even going through the addiction with them, that they were going to wind up dead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I know it never crossed my mind because we were taking care of what we were given.
Yeah.
The tools, the information we were given then, we said, okay, he's got this, we got this. Well, that's not the way it happens. If we don't have the right information, facts, to give to our families, then to our children, in our schools, medically, all, it's every, like, what does Anthony say? Every avenue. There's many places that are broken right now and have been for years. Mm. And if we don't get in there and do something about it, we're going to continue this.
Yeah.
This is not going to end. We know we're not ending addiction, right?
Yeah.
But we can sure as heck make a difference that we have to make those younger people understand that while you're afraid to talk to this about your children at a young age, I'm going to say it. Be more afraid you might have to pick out a casket. Okay. I never thought this was going to happen. Nobody thinks that that's going to really happen.
Not my kid.
No. Yeah. And in a different way, right?
Yeah.
And not my kid. Well, yeah, I admit he was an addict and I admit, and he admitted it. In fact, he preferred the term addict to substance use disorder type stuff. Not to say that that's not correct to change the language, but if we don't do the work ourselves, families, how do we expect to bring them home and continue that relationship to keep them well? And to and make, we are in recovery as well. We're devastated during addiction.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, so that's not the kid that I remember raising.
Right.
So families in supportive treatment helped me with that a lot. Yes. Yeah.
So there's a saying I heard an Indian use, an American Indian, in the recovery community, that if you take a sick tree out of the forest and nurse it back, when you put that healthy tree back, if you haven't cultivated the soil you removed it from, that that healthy tree now is going back into the depleted soil again and will only die again. So
that's a good analogy.
You know, so while the young person or your loved one, young or old, while they are seeking their recovery and their process, the family needs to do the same. You don't realize what the what it has done to relationships, what it has done to your mental health, having someone struggling for so long. I spoke to a neurologist one time that explained that after trauma and crisis, over a short period of time, it changes the way your brain reacts. Well, families, as the one sick and suffering, goes through long periods of crisis and trauma with the disease of addiction. So many times they are maintaining just to not be sick. And over time, that changes your brain. So the family needs education, needs recovery, needs support and encouragement rather than shame and blame and isolation.
Absolutely.
Well put, Claudia.
Yes. Yeah.
Wow.
Sorry. Yes. I just made me think of that when you were saying, you know,
I'm so sorry for the loss of your sons. I mean, I lost my brother, and it affects the whole family.
It does.
Absolutely. And not, you know, during the time it's happening, after forever. And
if I may, when my son passed away, I was blessed enough to have coworkers give me time. So I was home for 6 months before I had to go back to work. And I was on the computer looking for any and everything that I might want to wrap my head around, like the whys.
And this was back in
2014.
Okay.
This is before I met Claudia. And I went to, 6 weeks later, that's where I met Anthony and saw Claudia at the sidelines.
Anthony Rizzuto?
Yeah. And I said to myself, I said, she's important. Because she had, I don't know, she was standing up and she really wasn't saying much, but she was all in. And there were other moms and people there that I've met since I, 3 weeks later, I got on a bus with these people like strangers. 48 of us, really not knowing each other. And now most of them are still, not only do I know them, but they're my family. Claudia being my sister right here. And, but 9 weeks later, getting on the bus, my husband said, you sure you want to do this? Dropping you off at the bus stop at 5:30 in the moon? You know, it's dark and cold and whatever.
What are you doing?
For the Mother's Day thing, press conference
up in Albany.
Yep. And I said, you know what? I don't know, but I know I can't. I have to. I just don't know. And 4 or 5 hours up to Albany, I got to meet and know a lot of these people. Some in recovery, some still out there, practitioners and clinicians. And I said, wow, this is what we need. Unity.
That was a mixed bag.
That was like an aha moment for me, and very, very sad, because if I had seen that in my life before, maybe I could have been more helpful to my son or families. And it bothers me that people, I'm going to say it as lovingly as possible. People who have children that are have embarked not yet on any of this, learn what you can.
Yeah.
Before.
Get the tools
before it's too
before
late.
Before you need the weapons. Mm-hmm. You don't want to be weaponizing against the fight against drugs and all that. How about let's being more sympathetic and empathetic and finding the tools that we all need in a family.
Right.
For to the prevent. Children. Yes, to
for
help
prevention.
Prevent.
Prevention.
Prevention. Yeah. And if it wasn't for these people on the bus, my husband is my rock. My oldest boy is literally right there for me. Mm. But my people, because they get it.
Yeah.
You know, it means isolation would have killed me.
Mm. Carol refers to it as the club nobody wants to be a part of.
Yeah, yes. We all, yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah we all do. Agree on yeah. that. But. Yeah. That was what we called the magic bus ride.
That's right.
Because
that's right.
for all of us, you know, some of us who, like myself, who had been advocating for a long time, what we found was that so many organizations and events would happen right after a crisis or an overdose. Mm. But then, you know, after a few weeks, the interest would die out, the attention would die off, or, you know, they focus on something else. That's what happened in my school district. It went from a drug and alcohol prevention task force to a anti-bullying and cybersecurity task force, and they totally left out
it was
addiction
it was because that was what was that popular was
at that time yeah. in the moment. But when I got on that bus ride with so many people from so many different backgrounds and so many different situations,
yes,
that's levels. What we needed. Yeah. We needed some people in government. We needed some people in healthcare. We needed families who have had this experience. We needed people who were in recovery, those people who were seeking recovery and weren't mm-hmm. sure they were even ready for it. And right. all of us together, that was magical. Mm-hmm. And that made such a big difference. And I might add that that bus ride and those talks that we had with legislators was one of the key factors. I wouldn't say it was the factor, but we got 23 bills passed that year.
Wow.
Yeah,
23.
Amazing. 11 out of 23.
Well, 11 out of 23? Mm-hmm.
All right. So that's
yeah.
all,
either way,
but it was,
you're still shooting pretty
yeah,
good
yeah,
there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah.
It was
yeah.
awesome.
Still good.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
We and it was over time.
Yes.
Like
yes.
some of them came right over that year, but
it was amazing.
They came.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to check that number.
Yeah.
I read one
I
of your letters.
It was 23.
The opioid task force.
Yes.
Right?
Did you?
Right.
Yeah.
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 It was very moving.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Those were hard. Those were hard times. There were a lot of people that spoke and yeah. a lot of different ideas. And, you know, again.
It's almost 10 years ago.
Yep.
But
yes.
Yeah, and a lot has changed. I'm curious.
Changed.
I bet fentanyl probably wasn't brought up at that time.
Nope.
No.
Yeah.
You didn't
no.
hear about that. Mm-mm.
No. Even no. though, ironically, if that's the right word to use, Paulette's grandson
yeah,
from Gabriel's Giving Tree.
Right. 15 years ago.
He was, 15 years ago, he was only 15 years old, and that is what he passed from.
Really?
Yeah.
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 So it was around.
It was around.
Not,
right.
not to the extent
not
it is now.
No, not,
right.
it wasn't in everybody's anything. No.
Yeah. Well,
yeah.
It wasn't in anybody's purview. But the bottom line is that's just the drug of the day.
Today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
This will always be happening.
Yes.
Bottom line,
yes.
until we address the issue mm-hmm. of mental health
yeah.
and talking about our feelings mm-hmm. and it being okay to not be okay and for us to be comfortable in our awkwardness.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we're never going to get rid of this.
Compassion
and empathy.
Empathy is huge.
Oh, and addressing the traumas in our life.
Yeah.
We don't address the traumas that we've... Same thing with families. That's
right.
why it's so important.
Yeah.
For families to get the support
right.
during
generational trauma.
After.
We talk
That's
about
right.
that
yeah.
all
yep.
the time.
And yeah.
you're just going to continue.
It perpetuates.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
it just will never go away unless it's talked about. And
absolutely.
I think the work that you're doing is so heroic. You're mm-hmm. doing God's work. Mm-hmm. Thank you, ladies.
We always say it was divine intervention and we got on
right.
the bus. So
yeah.
I agree.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and I think it's interesting Well, I thought it was really interesting that you were going to be on the air this week because I had a significant loss. My buddy Andrew Johnson passed away suddenly, and it's been a really, really, really hard week. And
so sorry, Kurt.
The isolation.
Yes,
that was the first thing. I was like, okay, like,
yeah,
I really want to do that. And it's just been a really long process and trying to sift through all the feelings and everything, and talking about it with everybody, and you almost get talked out after a certain point.
Right.
But the general underlying theme that I have seen with all of the friends that I've made over the years that I've then buried, which is more than most people, is not staying connected. Right. To whatever that is. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for me, it is my support network of sober yeah. people. Mm-hmm. It's Hope House. Yeah. It's the podcast. It's Allison. It's right. you. It's stuff like that. And when you don't have that, it's so easy to just slip through the cracks, right. you right. know?
Yeah. And you spiral down.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. you go down that rabbit hole mm-hmm. of darkness.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
yeah. 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 So it's been forcing me a lot this week to think about like how do I reach out more? How do I offer that hand to the person who, you know, isn't maybe the most social person or doesn't know how to ask for that or whatever. So it's been a really interesting week of reflecting, and I was grateful that you were going to be here today because I thought it'd be good to unpack some of it with you.
So agreed. And we had talked a little bit earlier about what you were experiencing, which I'm sure everybody has told you is very normal.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And sometimes saying nothing but being around other people mm-hmm. is just as important so yeah. that you're not sitting alone in a room. That's why the bus for us is so magical. We can sit alone and not talk, but be physically there
yeah.
for right. each other,
right. yeah.
and know what we're going through,
mm-hmm. right?
You know,
right.
and that's why absolutely. It is so important to stay connected.
Right.
Yes.
However, you are allowed to go through your own feelings and sit in it.
Mm-hmm.
Just don't sit in it alone.
Too long.
Well, that was right. and yeah. yesterday. Yeah. I was sitting alone.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Joe calls me. My buddy Joe calls yeah. me, and he's like, "What are you doing?" I'm like, "Well, I'm just sitting here." "What are you doing?" He's like, "I'm just sitting here." And he's like, "We shouldn't be doing this." He's like, "I'm coming over." You know,
good.
And it was
yeah.
like, and
yeah.
that was the best thing. Good. We got some food and right. we talked and we cried some more. And you know, it's gonna be.
Yeah.
It's just a reminder, you know, it's just a reminder for me, at least in my recovery and my own journey, mm-hmm. that it is so important.
And may I just say, what I always think about is you're in recovery and that comes first, right? But you, when you lose a friend mm-hmm. or the amount of friends mm-hmm. that a person your age, I lost one person in my life by your age. Mm-hmm. I can't imagine going through, in general, losing mm. that many friends or people mm. that you know, young people mostly. Then on top of it, trying to remain in recovery, I give yeah. you all the yeah. kudos well, thank you. In
if
the
anything,
world.
It's more motivation, honestly. Yes. It really is just like, I don't want to become that statistic. And I knew him so mm. well. I lived with him for years. He was intimately part of my group of friends.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And the amount of times he said, "I've got this," you know, yeah. he didn't say "I've got this," but that he was very confident. He was very yes, sure of himself. And we yeah. easily yeah. can, I'm guilty yeah. of that. I fall into that every day where I'm like, I've got this, you know, and it was like such a, really stopped me in my tracks and was like, you know, you never have this mm-hmm. and it never ends. And that is something that I need to,
yeah,
you, stay absolutely. On top
you
of.
Need to absolutely. Embrace yeah. recovery for a lifetime.
Yes. Yes.
It
yes.
is not a stage.
No.
It is not in passing. So,
and I know that.
That's right.
I know that.
Yes.
And then stuff like this happens and I look and I go, "Wow, you really were yeah, slipping a lot."
This is the right.
Yeah.
Right.
So it's like reflecting. This is I, yes. I in the, mm-hmm. at the end of the day I'm like, "Thank mm-hmm. you." You know,
yes.
like thank you.
Right.
You really
yeah.
this week I have mm-hmm. suffered a lot. I have cried a lot. I've gone through a lot. Mm-hmm. But like I thank you cuz you know yeah. what? Like you really showed me a lot this week.
So
yeah,
mm-hmm.
you we know, have to go to our mid wrap now.
Okay,
not to cut everybody off, but we'll come right back
yes,
around to
yeah,
this
yeah,
afterwards.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So,
Stopped everybody in their tracks.
So by now, almost everyone, just as we were saying, almost everyone knows someone who has died from this cause. I just heard a statistic, 1 out of 10 people know someone that has died this way. We must remember that these deaths are preventable. Each one of us has the power to make a difference. To all the parents out there, we understand that these conversations can be challenging. Let's equip ourselves with knowledge, resources, and empathy for crucial discussions with our kids and loved ones. And to everyone, talk to the people you love. Your words and support can be life-changing. It may be the most crucial discussion you'll ever have with them. Fentanyl has flooded the street drug supply. Taking one pill can be a life-ending decision. One pill can kill. So I'd like to play a song. This song is very meaningful to me from when I was younger, and I believe to many others it has a powerful message. We all want the same thing, love and acceptance in our life. So here's Foreigners, I Want to Know What Love Is. We will be right back with our special guests, Claudia Friszell and Lori Carbonaro. You are listening to WUSB Stony Brook 90.1 and 107.3 FM. We'll be right back.
I've got to take a little time, a little time to think things over. In case I need it when I'm older. Now this mountain I must climb feels like the world upon my shoulder. Through the clouds I see love. Keeps me warm as life grows colder. In my life, there's been heartache and pain. I don't know if I can face it again. Can't stop now. I've traveled so far to change this lonely life.
Welcome back, everyone, to Play It Forward on WUSB Stony Brook. I'm excited to have Claudia Friszell and Lori Carbonaro with us today. So we're going to pick up right where we left off.
I don't know exactly where we left off at this point, but...
After you cut us off.
Yeah, I know. I cut everybody right off. But yeah...
Actually, I was going to bring up, because we talked about it when we stopped. I'm sorry. I'm just going to interrupt for it. And that is talking about when you find a group and you start going to a meeting and you get complacent in, it's the same thing with grief.
Mm-hmm.
Just as in recovery, your recovery is for a lifetime. So is the family's, and grief. You're going to be processing that grief for the rest of your life. Right. So you need to make sure that you're not isolating yourself and staying alone and talking about it and going through. They say there are 5 stages. I say there are
55.
Right.
And be prepared to go through them all day like this.
Right. And for a lifetime. I'll go weeks that are okay, and then I'll hear a song. I'll smell something, you know. My son became a much better cook than I am early on, because he died at 18. And let me tell you, he definitely took what little bit I was able to teach him. And every once in a while, so we both loved steak and fresh beefsteak tomatoes. Oh. So every once in a while, I have to make myself a meal of steak and tomato salad, you know, mm-hmm. fresh from the garden.
Nice.
And it just is
that
like,
smell brings
it's a
you
way,
right back.
Oh,
yeah.
Brings you back. Brings
Absolutely.
You back. But it's a process.
And that's why we say all the time, we just said this before too, about celebrating their life.
Mm.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard, right? Because you do have to grieve, but it makes it, I'm closer to my son now by celebrating his life. Mm-hmm. He was, just like Claudia's son, too young. Anybody's too young. Too young. Mm-hmm. But 22, and, you know, it's like, it was a short span that now I remember everything. Mm-hmm. I try to do everything. Isolation wouldn't afford me that.
Mm-hmm.
I would sit there in it, not for too long, and then get up and do something that I remember him, or as a family we would get together and do. And that's like what the beating hearts is all about. The healing through remembering our children is so much nicer. I don't begrudge anyone's grief process, by no means, but I think remembering and celebrating them helps a lot of people.
Yeah.
In our circle.
Yeah.
Well, and that's, you know, like I have to, you know, like I was saying before, like I'm at this point, not at this point, right now in this moment, let's say, you know, like I have to look at, like, you know, what would he be saying right now?
Right.
You know, and what would he want? And he would want us to look and reflect and learn from this.
Yeah.
And to, you know, kind of keep his memory alive by, at least for myself, reflecting on those changes and how I can improve to be better. And, you know, I think that that's really how you keep. At least that's how I'm going to keep his memory alive, is by trying to do that, you know?
Yeah, actually, that was one of the biggest reasons Carol Trotter started the Purple Rock project.
Mm-hmm.
Learning how to save a life with a Narcan overdose, and to take a Purple Rock. Purple is the color for recovery, and putting your loved one's name on that. So it's Carol's project, and Lori
with Carahan.
With Carahan.
Yes. Yeah. Kara and Carol, and probably you, went down to the beach and picked those rocks.
Right.
And they painted the rocks.
Climbed them up 100
and
steps.
Yes.
Right.
You know, I mean, there was a lot of love there.
Right.
Yeah,
a lot of love there.
And it means so much. When we had the first one in Port Jeff at the farmer's market, we trained 95 people at the farmer's market.
Mm.
And it's all about, like we always, we're saying it now, meeting people where they're at. I'm sure families didn't go to the farmer's market and expect
to get a
Narcan training.
Honey, and cucumbers and Narcan.
Right.
But believe it or not, moms and dads with their little kids got trained in Narcan, learned
That's
something,
amazing.
Brought the kid home, and whoever needed to do or wanted to do the rock
painting.
And then they went back. We took the rocks to Gabriel's Giving Tree at SeaTuck Preserve. And that's where they're residing right now. Now, they're probably going to be all over the island by the time Overdose Awareness Day, because we're having another one in on the 25th. August 25th. 3 to 7 at the
Three Village Farmers Market. 3 to 7
3 to 7 1099 North Country Road in Stony Brook.
Come on down.
Come on down.
Go see the Rock the Purple Island.
Yes.
Or the Rock the Island Purple.
The Purple
Rock Island.
Goodness. We can just, you know, make all different kinds of purple.
There will be music. And dancing,
Well, so, but that's it. You got to bring this conversation into the community, because obviously, people out of fear, out of non-understanding or no education, people don't realize that you need to bring it out into the open, and they won't come to you. So we come to
them.
I would like to mention that. Whoever's going to attend that farmer's market and see Carol and Claudia and Lori and even Kurt and I and maybe even Bridget, we bring a small photo of your loved one, of someone that you lost, because they will be able to Mod Podge
the picture onto the rock.
Right. Yes, and with the dates. And so, I think this is important community work that is being done, and it is about bringing everyone together for this cause. Right. And I think with that, people start seeing the compassion and the caring, and you know, I don't want any parent to ever have to go through what you went through.
Right.
And nowadays, it's even scarier because, you know, what we were saying before, not my kid.
Right.
You know, a lot of these kids that are dying are not addicted. They're experimenting now.
Right.
Which is something.
Not that it matters.
Because it's all poison, let's face it.
It's all poison.
Yeah. But the fentanyl poisoning is specifically for greed, let's be honest.
Oh, absolutely.
Right. And it's in general, it's just bad, right? It's horrible. Nobody should have to go through that. But I can imagine if you didn't expect to, as a person, taking Adderall, taking a Xanax for the first time or any time, having it fentanyl laced, it's
right.
It's over.
That's it.
Yeah.
And I believe in I know that the one pill can kill. No. I say one pill does kill.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I agree.
Because there's more and more every day, and it's a full sense of security saying can to me. That's my personal opinion.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Wow.
Deteriorating.
Yeah. So I think that's a good transition to into what our organization's vision is, you know, and that is to get our message across to young people. Lori and I were talking about this. Actually, the three of us were talking about this the other night. You know, getting this into schools from elementary through college.
And elementary. We did say elementary.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think by middle school.
Yeah.
I don't want to say it's too late.
No.
But you.
Well, you don't have to, because my son was on, and that's literally what he said. You know, he's like, you don't want to be 14 and then it's too late because they've already tried it.
That's right.
You know, to hear an 11-year-old saying that, I was like, oh, okay.
And people, I think, like 14, but that is how old they are.
And you know, you talk to them where they're at.
Right.
You're going to talk differently to a 7-year-old than you would to a 14-year-old. But if you start the conversation at 7, it's a lot less awkward than it is for the with a 14-year-old who has already tried it.
And they're already in that awkward stage. Yes. Where like, I don't want to talk about this with you. But if you start young, and it's not just one conversation.
It's ongoing.
The car is the best place to talk to your kids. Yep. I always say that.
Captive audience.
Yes.
Literally.
Talk to your kids about this. And as young as 7, 6, even 5 maybe. Yep. Especially if you have people in your family that are struggling.
Exactly. If it's a hereditary. Yeah, absolutely. If it's in your family, you're a fool not to talk about it.
It has to be talked about. Though, if you think your kids don't know what's going on, they absolutely do.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. When my son passed away at 18, I had a 16-year-old daughter, a 5-year-old, and a 3-year-old. And they're, you know, all of a sudden we had a million people at the house, and I had to start the conversation. You know, my son was in recovery at that moment, so, and we had just seen him that weekend, so we had already started having the conversation about Mark's illness and what he suffered from, as best as you can to a 3 and 5 year old. Obviously my 16-year-old had a better understanding of it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But so we continued that, and then of course, you know, then his passing. So, you know, for these families and friends and the community, you've barely been able to grasp the disease of addiction, and now you have to deal with grief on top of that.
Yeah. Right.
So important. You know, if your child goes to school at 5 years old, you're going to research the curriculum, the teachers, the school district. You should also research the social issues that you're that they're going to be facing.
Yeah.
And this is part of that.
May I add this?
Yes.
Because of the school districts that don't really have a lot of prevention in place. As young people buying your home and you're looking at your district for schools and such, you need to actually look at that, because if they're not willing to actually, besides checking the box with an assembly on occasion and things like that, if they're not doing really the best they can do for your kids, maybe that's a district you don't want to be in.
Well, what does that look like?
As far as?
As these school districts that are, like, what?
Well, districts do, administrators, each school, not even each district, or, like, I belong to Middle Country School District, and, every school doesn't offer the same programs. Right. So what makes this school over here that said yes to all the great stuff? Well, and this school, we'll just do the assembly and we'll do this, whatever. There's the imbalance is actually killing people.
Right.
Or starting addiction, I should at least say.
Right.
But go ahead.
So there are programs, most districts.
That are free, by the way.
Right. Most districts will check the box, so to speak, with New York State and federal guidelines by having an assembly in maybe 9th or 10th grade once.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
Once.
Too late and not enough.
Too late enough is
right.
Way
that's
beyond.
Not,
way
it's
beyond.
Not,
it's but there are really good programs out there. I almost don't want to speak about the DARE program, but it was a program that started in elementary school.
With good intentions.
With good intentions.
Right.
Yes. It was a failure, but we should have learned from that and
failure. Built on it or something.
And, right, exactly.
And built on that and continued. No, they just threw the program out and then that was it.
Yeah.
There's
nothing
else.
Nothing back up. No backup.
There was another program, Too Good for Drugs, which is kind of, yeah, I know, you made a face too. I did as well. I actually fought that title because that just didn't sound right to me. But that was another program that, although I may not have liked the title, it had a program it was a curriculum for elementary, for middle school and high school. And it was carried through the school year. Mm-hmm. It wasn't an everyday program. I think it was more like a health or a library or art. It was like once a week or twice a week, depending on the district. But there are no uniform guidelines, and there's nothing uniform across the board anywhere. And very few districts do much of anything.
Right.
That is part of our vision. We have a vision with our organization, Play It Forward, to get this message out to young people on a regular basis with hands-on speakers
peer
from Hope House, people that
peer-to-peer
is the key word.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We have an idea where we would like to, for each school district we go to, appoint a couple of students to represent their school. Be youth ambassadors for this cause, where they continue this advocacy. Because I've been a teacher for many years, and when you empower children to help each other.
Yes.
That's when, mm-hmm. when you see things happen.
They, reading buddies. Mm-hmm. It was, mm-hmm. It's the right? same thing.
Safety
right?
patrol for me mm-hmm. in sixth grade. Yeah. I had that mm-hmm. badge, and it was like, I felt like I could change the world. You yeah. know?
She still yeah. has that badge.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
All my Mount Sinai friends, you probably. Yeah. But yeah. I.
No, that's great. And yeah. Yeah. Lori and I were talking, and Lori said we need that for parents, too.
Oh, absolutely. A parents' academy, you
we
know,
need
where
a
they
parents
learn
academy
while
and
the kids are learning.
Ambassadors. Yep. Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. I mean, like, we've been, I've been in my district because mm-hmm. we got together for the round table and we sat there and. I don't get invited really much by email. I kind of get lost sometimes because I speak my mind. And they have this idea, which is great, that the now the public surrounding area doesn't want. Kids that come home from treatment that want to go back to school have a hard time because what school is, right? Mm-hmm. It's going to be, it's not fixed for them, right? There's right. no, although I did have somebody, one of Nick's friends that came to the house after Nick passed away and said, we were talking about recovery high schools.
I was, yeah.
And while we only have one, I believe, still on the island, correct?
There might be two.
He said to me, but Ma, why isn't every high school run like a recovery high school?
Yeah, right?
Yes.
Right? Mm. Instead of, now we have metal detectives and we have security mm-hmm. and the guns and all these extra things that kids are worrying about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
On top of the fact, bullying, internet. I mean, there's so much more. How about meditation instead of detention? How about all these other mindfulness kind of techniques?
Yeah, right.
And
coping
the
skills. Coping yes. skills.
And the peer-to-peer thing, I think, gets a lot of that in there.
Right.
Yeah.
I really do. I think that it's a nice formula. And having parents involved in it, too.
Yeah.
You know, nobody even goes to PTA anymore.
Hmm. Well, I mean, I think some of them are afraid they're going to be, like...
Oh, put on a board yeah. or yeah, a committee yeah, to do right. something? Right. Yeah,
it's
yeah.
It's become kind of a stigma in a right. way.
Yes.
Yeah, which is yeah. amazing to me. I just, you know, I got thrown out of one in particular because I just don't get it. I just don't understand why we're talking about the amount of toilet paper or paper towels and... Mm-hmm. Really?
Let's talk about the tough
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, you know,
yeah. Let's talk about Narcan.
Right. Right.
Yeah,
you
yeah. know? And why isn't it a high school... health
mandated
room kind of thing
yeah.
in especially in high school right to learn that and have it in the schools. That's a whole nother ball of wax that is going
to
melt all over
we
if everybody don't
mandate
do no
period
you shouldn't.
You mandate something and everybody's going to not want to do mm-hmm. that
yeah
right. that's
yeah.
like
right.
telling your kid
yep.
you better be home on time
exactly.
they're
going
to make sure they're at least exactly. 5 minutes late just yeah. to
why,
piss you
why
off.
Shouldn't you want to do that right why shouldn't you want to do that I'm sorry, I'm not laughing at that comment.
Yeah.
But yeah, it gets me.
Yeah.
It gets me.
So we're all on board. We're ready to rally with you guys.
Oh yeah.
For
yeah. And speaking of that, since
school.
We talked about the purple mm-hmm. Long Island Rocks, purple Island Rocks, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Purple.
Big purple rock.
Big purple rock. That Long Island
Rock,
is.
Long Island rock, purple.
Rock line purple.
Okay. Okay.
All right.
That's
tongue twister.
Yeah. September 23rd, Claudia and I and several other people are going to Washington for the Trail of Truth.
Okay.
By the way.
What is the Trail of Truth, Lori?
The Trail of Truth is when, okay, so we're we have, I think, 42 states so far that have registered. Somewhere along the line, we're going to Washington. Truth Farm has started this three, four years ago. And what some of us don't feel comfortable doing is they send out stuff for making these tombstones if you've lost a loved one.
Oh, wow.
And you bring these tombstones with you or they place them in right there
as
in everybody's
visual.
As
wow.
a visual. It's very impactful.
Mm-hmm.
We walk from, I forget where it is now, to Union Square, and we're going to put them, and it's really amazing. It really is amazing. Now, it's not for everyone.
Mm.
Most parents, you know, they back and forth.
Mm.
Can I do that?
Right.
We are going from Long Island this year with a banner.
Right.
Long Island, pain to purpose.
Right.
And we are going to have, whether they're with us or not, they're going to be with us on the banner, all the grassroots 501
right.
C3POs. They're gonna we're gonna put their logos
right. Most on the of banner. Those organizations were started by families who have had a sudden loss,
right.
or they have a loved one that struggles with addiction
right.
and is seeking recovery or in recovery. So that's why it's so important to us to bring them with us. Truth in Pharma is against all the pharmaceutical companies
yes.
that have lied to us for years.
Check them out on the yeah. website. Mm-hmm. It's amazing.
Yeah. They're doing really great stuff
really great
to
stuff.
Educate the community and our legislators as to all the harm that they have done
right.
and, you know, that they are actual drug dealers, legal drug dealers,
mm-hmm.
yep.
And
mm-hmm.
they need to be held accountable and, you know, in your face,
mm-hmm.
in your face.
So if you want to come. Get on board.
Oh, yeah.
We're there.
On the bus. Yeah.
No, well,
like in
no,
all the bus references.
So far, there's no bus.
We're going to try and get a bus.
But that's we're going to try.
Gonna.
Oh, wait, we're
so
trying.
Are we.
We'll let you know.
Yeah. All right.
It would be great.
Yeah.
Now, like Stony Brook
buses.
Students,
okay.
you might want to join us. We could get a big enough bus.
Yeah.
That would be pretty awesome.
Oh,
yeah.
wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
if you're interested, you can reach out to us at sbu.playitforward on Instagram.
Thank you, Kurt. Yeah, we're just about to wrap up here, but I want to thank both of you, ladies,
thank you.
For being with us today.
And for doing what you do,
oh, yeah.
you know, and being the awesome support that you are to so many people. You know, I can speak just from knowing them from the community.
Right. Yes.
That's how I met them, and I've known Claudia for I've known both of you for probably 7 years now.
Oh, yeah. Help me move them in my house.
Yes.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah, and
right.
and I can say, you know, like, you guys really are out there on the front lines.
Oh, yeah.
Doing
boots
what needs to be
ground.
Done. Boots on the
that's
ground.
It.
That's it. That's
I met
it.
You yeah. both at the press conference last year. And
yes.
Oh, that's right.
I see you. You're everywhere.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Nonstop. This, like bull yeah. in a china shop.
Right. Yeah.
yeah.
And I think it's awesome. And Kurt, you too.
Yeah.
Thank you for what
thank
you.
You
do.
Yeah.
You are helping so many people
yes.
with mm-hmm. your story. And mm-hmm. thank you for being so vulnerable to share. Mm-hmm. I know this has been a really hard week for you. And
yes.
really so sorry.
And if anybody's out there struggling, reach out. Reach
yeah.
out to us. You
oh
can
my God, reach
get
out.
My,
any of
you
us.
Can yeah,
any of
you'll
us.
Get my number.
Yeah.
I'll call you. You can talk
yeah.
to me. You know, you're not alone out there, and there's a lot of resources. Try to stay connected. Try to find somebody to get honest with and stay connected with.
Right.
And tell people around you that you love them.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
Tell everybody in your life
that
you love them. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
you don't know what people
yeah.
are going through.
Yeah.
Hugging wasn't bad either.
My good friend Hunter found a statistic that most men don't receive flowers in their life until their funeral.
Oh. Wow.
So he bought flowers and stood on the corner in New Jersey and handed out flowers
wow.
to every man that walked past him.
I love that.
And would not take no for an answer.
Wow.
And was like, no, like the next time you're going to have a flower is probably at your
I'm
funeral.
I'm going to send
wow.
you flowers
yeah.
later, Kurt.
That's awesome.
Isn't that cool, though? So,
yes.
yeah, reach out to
yeah.
people. Tell them
yeah.
you love them. Tell
yeah.
your guy friends you love them. Don't
yeah.
be afraid to tell them
yeah.
you love them. That's
yes.
all. Sorry.
Yeah,
go
people
on.
Talk about
yeah.
this. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much,
thank you,
Claudia
thank you.
And Lori, for being our guests today and sharing your hard work. For more information about FIST, you could visit them at
there's
Family
a
and support,
Families and
Supported
treatment.
Treatment.
We're under the umbrella of LICAD now.
Oh, we have LICAD's hotline number
yes.
coming
you
up
go.
Shortly.
And
you
thank you. I
also,
do run a family support group
right.
on Thursday nights at
FIST.
Thrive. It's FIST Family Hope.
Good.
7
oh,
to 9. And it doesn't have to be my support group.
Any
there
support group.
Any
mm-hmm.
support
yep.
group. Al-Anon,
Seek support.
Families.
Yes. It's
yes.
there.
Yeah.
It's out there, everyone.
Yes. Yeah.
So I sincerely thank everyone who supports this cause and understands how important it is to look out for each other and to empathize with anyone you know dealing with addiction. Please educate one another about illicit fentanyl and various harm reduction measures such as Narcan and fentanyl test strips. We have ample support from various community-based groups, including AA, NA, Smart Recovery, Case Management, and more. Reach out to us via Instagram at sbu.playitforward for more recommendations.
Fentanyl test strip. Oh, I'm sorry. Are you feeling overwhelmed, struggling with mental health and substance use? You don't have to go through it alone. SAMHSA's Treatment Referral and Info Helpline is 1-800-662-HELP. If you prefer to text, you can send a message to help for you, all one word. SAMHSA also has 24/7 information service that offers free confidential assistance for mental health and substance use disorder. The number for this service is 1-800-487-4889. Another resource is Hope House Ministries. You can learn about Hope House online at hhm.org. You call Hope House's number 631-928-2377. LICAD, Long Island Council on Alcoholism and Drug Dependence, provides support, intervention, and can be reached at 631-979-1700, and its website is licad.org.
Thank you, Kurt. And on behalf of Play It Forward, thank you all for listening. We invite you to join us on Instagram and check out our YouTube channel. So for now and always, keep playing it forward. Thank you, everyone. This is Allison of the Play It Forward Project, and I hope you tune in to our next show on September 1st from 1 to 2 p.m. Our next guest will be Larry Lemondola of the Levittown Community Action Coalition. You guys know him?
Oh, yeah.
And Wantagh Lions Club. Shout out to Larry. We'll see you in a couple of weeks. Again, thank you, WUSB. Thank you, Tyrone. Mm. Thank you, Kurt. Mm. And shout out to Taylor.
Yes.
And, of course, to our special guests, Claudia and Lori. God bless you both. Thank you so much. And I understand you have a special song you would like to play.
Yes. Yeah. So the song, and Kurt knows this song as well, it is...
Go Light Your World.
Yes.
Go. So here is Go Light Your World, and it is... The guys from Hope House.
The hymns in Carnegie Hall a couple of years ago.
So you are listening to WUSB Stony Brook 90.1 and 107.3 FM. Be well, everyone, and please look out for one another.